In this figure, we want to look at alveolar structure and the respiratory membrane, and we want to focus on a couple of key factors. One would be protection against both airborne particulate matter as well as protection against collapse. In other words, we don't want our alveoli to collapse every time we exhale. Another factor we want to focus on is maximizing the surface area available for diffusion of our respiratory gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide. Now, in this figure, what we've done is we've taken the terminal lung here, the very end of our Weibull model, where we have our clusters of alveoli, right? We breathe in and out of these sort of blind-ended bags, right? These many, many millions of alveoli. And we've blown them up down here at the bottom so we can see just a few of them. And so air moves in and out of our respiratory system in a pressure-driven fashion, right, through ventilation. But when you get to the very bottom here, right, gases are going to move in and out of these little openings into the alveolar sacs, right, these clusters of alveoli, through or via diffusion, right, because the air is slowing down more and more as we breathe into these blind-ended bags, the gases actually diffuse in and out of the alveoli. Now, the alveolar walls are constructed of these squamous cells known as type 1 cells. They are helping to minimize our diffusional distance, as we'll see in a moment. Type 2 cells are fewer in number, but very important. These are the surfactant-producing cells. This is the chemical that reduces the surface tension of the water lining the alveolar wall. You can see, if we blow it up over here on the right, we blow up this little section of the alveolar wall and where it meets up against a capillary, right? So we have air over here, and we have blood or plasma, the liquid portion of blood on this side, right? And the type 1 cells are forming half of this barrier between the air and the blood. Lining those cells would be this water layer we see right here. Well, those water molecules have a dipole. In other words, they are charged and they're attracted to each other. And so they tend to pull together. Right? We could repeat these arrows over and over again. They tend to pull together, sort of pulling that water together. Well, that tends to make these alveoli collapse, and of course that would tend to be catastrophic, right? As we would have to then reinflate all these alveoli with each breath. And so what we want to do is reduce that surface tension with the surfactant that we add to them. Now, in addition to those two types of cells, we also have these wandering white blood cells known as macrophages. We also call them dust cells because their primary job is to phagocytose or eat particulate matter, including dust and bacterial spores and fungal spores, which could accumulate or even infect these alveoli. And so these guys wander around and basically clean up that alveolar surface. Now, we also want to make sure that we point out our maximizing of gas exchange, right? Come back to this shared wall between the alveolar wall and the capillary wall, again, blown up here. And that's referred to as the respiratory membrane. And the respiratory membrane is a composite of the alveolar epithelium plus the capillary epithelium with a basement membrane, right? Some extracellular matrix proteins in between. And this is essentially the diffusional distance across which our gases must travel to move into or out of the body. That's really important because we need to look at our equation for diffusion, Fick's law. And we can see that, first of all, that surface area is very important. That's why we have 300 million of these individual alveoli to have a very large surface area. That, of course, is going to make our diffusion greater. And then also, we need to have a very small diffusional distance. Again, that would be the respiratory membrane, right? That's our barrier between blood and air. And so we want delta X to be very small so that diffusion can be very rapid.